from theCUBE studios in Palo Alto and Boston, bringing you data-driven insights from theCUBE and ETR. This is Breaking Analysis with Dave Vellante.
The time for Intel to shed its foundry business is now. While former CEO Pat Gelsinger made a persuasive case for US-based advanced semiconductor manufacturing, his vision was flawed from the start. Intel's foundry operation, like IBM's microelectronics business a decade ago, is an asset with essentially negative value. Yet its strategic significance for US competitiveness in the AI semiconductor race cannot be overstated. If financial institutions are deemed too big to fail, then Intel's foundry represents a similarly critical infrastructure for US national interests, in our view. Key questions about the future of Intel foundry services demand answers. One, is US-based advanced manufacturing vital to national security and global competitiveness? Two, does this manufacturing need to be controlled by a US headquartered company? Three, how can a spin-out of Intel's foundry operation be effectively funded? Four, what stakeholders are essential for the long-term success of a spun-out foundry entity? And finally, how long will it take for a new entity to become competitive in the market? Hello, and welcome to this special Breaking Analysis, which outlines a bold plan for spinning out Intel's foundry business, relying on a multi-stakeholder investment strategy from tech giants, private equity, and government funding, coupled with strategic partnerships with industry leaders like TSMC, or possibly even Samsung, because only TSMC, or maybe Samsung, has the necessary expertise to design, build, and operate modern foundries and get to profitability in a reasonable time frame. Well, let's look at the case for spinning out Intel's foundry business. The rationale for divesting Intel's business, its foundry business, is rooted in harsh economic realities. First, market dynamics. Intel's x86 business, the core driver of its wafer volumes, is in long-term decline. And by contrast, wafer demand and volumes for ARM processors dominated by TSMC is at least tenfold greater. Intel lacks the scale to compete in advanced manufacturing is the bottom line. That leads us to Wright's Law and cost challenges. According to Wright's Law, manufacturing costs decline as cumulative output increases. We've talked a lot about this on Breaking Analysis and other episodes of, for instance, the Cube Pod and other research. Intel's lower wafer volumes result in manufacturing costs that are, in our estimates, at best 30 to 35% higher than those of TSMC. Now, compounding this, Intel lags TSMC by approximately a year, based on our estimates, in achieving competitive yields for each new process node. Intel is incurring unsustainable losses in its foundry business. Intel's foundry operations, they're bleeding cash. In April, the company reported a staggering $7 billion operating loss on $19 billion in revenue, with a 31% revenue decline year over year. This financial trajectory is untenable. Erosion of competitiveness. As process nodes become more expensive, e.g. $25,000 per wafer at 2 nanometers, Intel's ability to remain competitive is shrinking. Without intervention, in our view, the foundry will remain a drag on Intel's broader business, which has great potential to flourish, in our opinion. Take a look at this table below, which shows how much more expensive each process node becomes. This chart shows prices, but it is proportional to cost. And because subsequent process nodes become more and more expensive per wafer, manufacturers need the combined power of Wright's Law and Moore's Law to continue to stay on the relentless price performance improvement curves that the tech industry is so famous for. Okay, so how do we save US-based advanced semiconductor manufacturing? We've got some key assumptions here. First, I don't think anybody's going to disagree that US-based manufacturing is vital. Domestic semiconductor manufacturing is essential for national security, economic resilience, and military posture. In our view, US ownership matters. A US-based headquartered entity ensures control over critical intellectual property and mitigates geopolitical risks such as potential Chinese takeover of Taiwan. Well, Chinese law would be difficult to enforce with a US-based manufacturer or external to China. it still gives China leverage on the global stage, and that's something that we don't feel is warranted. So our proposed solution is Intel's board must recognize the negative value of its foundry operation and act decisively to spin out IFS, Intel Foundry Services, as a joint venture, partner with TSMC. Let's park Samsung for a minute. Let's focus on TSMC to leverage their expertise in advanced manufacturing and engage strategic stakeholders. In our view, the board should secure investments from major U.S. tech companies, including Alphabet, Amazon, Apple, Meta, Microsoft, and NVIDIA, as well as from private equity firms and public funds under the CHIPS Act. We also believe Elon Musk personally should participate in the initiative and possibly other funding from the Department of Defense. In addition, we would recommend that the U.S. government redirect CHIPS Act funding and reallocates the $8 to $10 billion earmarked for Intel to a joint venture with multiple stakeholders to ensure the long-term viability of advanced U.S. manufacturing. Also, redirect other CHIPS Act funds toward the joint venture. Now, funding the spin-out. We are proposing a multi-stakeholder approach. The spin-out would require contributions from diverse stakeholders as outlined in this table. Just to put this into context, we did a scan on the balance sheets of these tech giants to see if they could afford it. Apple, Alphabet, Amazon, Microsoft, Meta, and NVIDIA combined currently have more than $500 billion on their balance sheets in cash and liquid securities. You throw in Elon and it's nearly $1 trillion. We're talking about 3% of their liquid assets to save US-based advanced semiconductor manufacturing. Ken, if you would do me a favor and go back to that previous chart, I just want to spend some time on it. So here we show the stakeholder, Apple, Alphabet, Microsoft, et cetera, the cash that we recommend that they contribute, the contribution type and the ownership stake. This would identify the reformed company and what the cap table would look like. So Apple, Alphabet, Microsoft, Amazon, and Meta would each put in $5 billion. NVIDIA would throw in $2 billion. Those companies combined have about $540 billion in cash and liquid securities on hand. And their ownership stakes would be 4.4% each, with NVIDIA at a 1.8% stake. As well, if Musk puts in $2 billion in cash out of his $400 billion plus net worth, he gets almost 2 points. TSMC is contributing significant capital and skills transfer. So it says here cash, but it's really not cash. It's really, they've got three facilities in the US that are ongoing. They're putting about $65 billion into that. And they've got skills transfer that are vital. That probably is more valuable even than those plants and property and equipment. But let's take half of that, $65 billion. Let's take a little less than half, roughly $30 billion. That gives TSMC a 26% ownership stake. You take about $30 billion from the CHIPS Act. That government funding gives it a similar funding from the government, so U.S. taxpayers. And then private equity puts in another $20 billion. And then, look, Intel equity holders, there's not a lot to contribute because it essentially has negative value today. So we'll dig into that a little bit. And explain it a little bit further. But at reInvent this year, I asked Matt Garman, AWS's CEO, is US-based advanced manufacturing critical to you? Is it important that the company is headquartered in the US, and would you be willing to fund it? And his response was, yes, not necessarily, and I'm not sure I want to fund it. The reality is that big tech players have had sort of a free ride in the silicon business. Granted, AWS made an amazing acquisition of Annapurna in 2015, and they put in, you know, roughly $350 million or whatever they paid. It wasn't publicly reported. That's not chump change, but compared to the return, it's a modest investment. And of course, AWS has put in more over time to get to Nitro and Graviton and Inferentia and Trainium. Google has invested in custom silicon and even has its own fab it just announced for Quantum. And Microsoft is just getting into the fray. But these firms, plus Apple, NVIDIA, Meta, and other firms like Tesla, they design their own chips and rely on the ARM standard and TSMC to make the chips at high yield. So TSMC is largely doing the dirty work, Samsung picks up a little of that volume as well. You know, sure, these customers pay for it, but just have another look at their cash reserves. Carving out $30 billion to save U.S. semiconductor manufacturing is not only a drop in the bucket, one could argue, given the wealth creation afforded by the United States miracle, it's obligatory. Now, I don't think this is going to go over too big with any of these firms, but we'll address that later on, why they should do it. But the bottom line is Intel's foundry business represents a critical yet unsustainable operation for the company with negative net worth. The solution is not to abandon it, but rather transform Intel Foundry through a collaborative approach, a spin-out supported by strategic investments from tech giants, private equity, and the U.S. government will create a competitive and independent entity capable of safeguarding U.S. semiconductor leadership. Such a venture anchored by partnerships with TSMC ensures the expertise needed to succeed while reducing Intel's financial burden. This path not only salvages a vital national asset, but also aligns with broader industry and geopolitical imperatives. Failure to act decisively risks bankruptcy for Intel and an end to achieving our leading-edge U.S. semiconductor ambitions, a risk, in our view, that is too great to ignore. Now, we've created a fact sheet that we'll use to close this episode. First question, why would Intel give away its manufacturing facilities for a minority stake in the new venture? For the same reasons IBM made the decision in 2014 and closed it in 2015 with Global Foundries, because Intel's foundry business is a drag on the company and Intel will go bankrupt in our view trying to compete with TSM for advanced manufacturing volumes. Every day that goes by risks losing more money and delays the resurgence of a more focused Intel. The company simply doesn't have enough cash or time to compete in advanced manufacturing without a radical change. Moreover, its investments in advanced technology and manufacturing are of negative value and declining in our view because the cost to build and run fabs and get to profitability are so exorbitant. Intel cannot sustain the 6 years minimum it will take to get competitive with TSMC and the 10 years to start making any profit. Okay, the second question, why would the U.S. government support this initiative? Because its current plan is too reliant on a doomed Intel foundry and spreads the CHIPS Act funding too thin. It just is not going to have, in our view, a sustainable impact, and this approach dramatically increases the chances of success, in our view. Three, how long will it take for the joint venture to be competitive in the market? More than a decade. We think it will take at least three cycles of advanced fabs, 2 years for each fab. The first factory will provide an entry point. The second one will get foundry to a steady state. And the third plant will cross over break even. Each cycle will last at least 2 years plus another year and a half or even 2 years to get acceptable yields. Our best case estimate is that it will take 10 to 12 years for the joint venture to become a self-sufficient and viable competitor. Four, why would the tech giants be interested in investing in the joint venture? Two reasons. One, to have a viable second source on U.S. soil. And two, it's a relatively small price to pay to get the U.S. government off their respective backs. Why would TSMC be interested in this venture? Three reasons. TSMC would be the largest shareholder in the venture. It hedges the looming threat of China. And three, it would win favor with the U.S. government in the broader ecosystem. Six, why would private equity be compelled to fund this venture with such a long time horizon for payback? Well, firms like Apollo and Brookfield have invested billions in Intel foundries that could become worthless. Other private equity firms with an appetite for long-term investment and investments in other tech firms may also be interested in coming to the deal to protect their investments and secure a US-based supplier. Why would Elon Musk be interested in investing in the joint venture? Elon, of all people, understands that the future of technology is dependent on a stable silicon supply chain. He can afford it. His firms, Tesla in particular, have an interest in semiconductor design, and it would be a small price to pay to further cement his legacy of solving really hard problems. Eight, should the U.S. government hold such a large equity position? No. The U.S. government should first get its foot off the neck of these big tech companies as a quid pro quo for their participation, and it should divest its position over time and give the proceeds back to taxpayers in the form of debt reduction. 9, are there other stakeholders that should be or could be involved? Yes, potentially IBM, given its situation with global foundries and the deep research and development expertise it has. A lot to add to the future of this venture, and I think IBM should be encouraged to participate. 10, what about global foundries or other US fabs like Texas Instruments or Micron? Should they be involved? Probably not. The Mubadala Investment Company, a sovereign wealth fund of the United Arab Emirates, is the largest shareholder of global foundries and probably is too controversial to be included. As well, global foundries and TI are focused on less advanced silicon process technologies and are doing well within their focus market segments. Let's leave them alone. Micron's fabs are focused on memory, including high bandwidth memory, a critical component of AI, but not critical to the venture in our view. What about Broadcom and other key players like EDA firms? Possibly, but these firms don't have the balance sheets of the largest tech firms mentioned above. What about the US Department of Defense and NATO? Should they contribute to the joint venture? Yes, we believe that would be a productive use of funds. And finally, what will be the governance structure of the new entity? In our view, there should be a balance of power, both for the operational makeup and board level presence. TSMC is contributing critical IP, so it must have a say in how the entity is run, and it's contributing, you know, key critical knowledge and expertise, and they're actually really good at this. At the same time, the entity will be a US-based firm, and it must have an executive team and independent board that is dedicated to the mission of returning US-based manufacturing to competitive prominence. No individual stakeholder should be able to carry so much weight so as to alter the trajectory of the joint venture from this important mission. Okay, that's it for now. What do you think? What's your solution to Intel and its foundry dilemma? I want to thank Alex Meyerson and particularly Ken Schiffman today on production and in our podcast. Kristen Martin and Cheryl Knight help get the word out on social media and in our newsletters. And Rob Hoff is our EIC over at SiliconANGLE.com. Thank you all. Remember, all these episodes are available as podcasts. Wherever you listen, just search Breaking Analysis Podcast. I publish each week on thecuberesearch.com and siliconangle.com, and you can email me at david.vellante@siliconangle.com or DM me at dvellante or comment on our LinkedIn posts. Even though we didn't use their data today, please do check out etr.ai for the best survey data in the enterprise tech business. This is Dave Vellante for theCUBE Research Insights, powered by ETR. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time on Breaking Analysis.